though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His compassion never fails. Every morning they are renewed. Jesus said, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and live again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. We brought nothing into the world, and we take nothing out. The Lord gives, and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." Let me, on behalf of the family, say thank you for coming to share this time with them. And I also want to acknowledge the presence of those who are viewing on social media. We are here to give God thanks for the life of Andrew Augustus, commonly known to us as Anderson. And I trust that as we would go through this service, the songs, thoughts expressed would help us to be able to deal with this difficult and trying time. I want to commend you for acknowledging and recognizing and following the protocols. I'm sure that were this under different circumstances, there would not be room enough. But because of what has been happening over the past maybe 18 months or so, we are now limited. However, we are glad that persons can still view. So let us bow our heads as we look to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you at this time with mixed emotions. There's a measure of joy because you would have given Andrew to us for some 75 years. There's a measure of sorrow because he's no longer with us. And so to this end, Lord God, we are asking that you would comfort the hearts of those who are mourning. We pray that as we would worship together, as we would seek to lift up the name of Jesus, that indeed we would recognize that underneath us are your everlasting arms. So, Father, we commend this time to you. In the name of Christ, we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. I'm going to ask that you remain standing as we sing that hymn, "Blessed Assurance." Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God.
This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
And just before we sit, there's another chorus that says, no grave can hold my body down. That's an old chorus, so I'm sure it might bring back some memories. And from what I've been told, Anderson loved music and singing and so on, so we certainly would want to honor that. No grave can hold my body down. No grave can hold my body down. When the trumpet shall sound and the dead in Christ shall rise, no grave can hold my body down. No grave can hold my body down. No grave can hold my body down. When the trumpet shall sound and the dead in Christ shall rise, no grave can hold my body down. No grave can hold my body down. No grave can hold my body down. When the trumpet shall sound, the dead in Christ shall rise. No grave can hold my body down. No grave can hold my body down. No grave can hold my body down. When the trumpet shall sound, the dead in Christ shall rise. No grave can hold my body down. Amen. You may sit, please. At this time, Anthony Sargent, he's going to come and give us the eulogy. And after that, we'll have our first scripture lesson, Psalm 46.
Good afternoon, all. What man is he that liveth and shall not see death? That was an extract from the 89th book of Psalms, found in the King James Version of the Holy Bible. And obviously, I would not want an answer from you because the answer is fairly unanimous. Death is inevitable. It is not habitual for any human being to wish for death. Unbearable pains and ailments may lead a person to think about death as the only solution or relief. Yet Jonah's displeasure caused him to say, and I quote, "It is better for me to die than to live." And that too is an extract from the King James Version as well, found in the book of Jonah, chapter 4, verse 3. This afternoon, I am thankful to be alive and able to accede to the request of sisters Kathy Ann and Bonnellin, who inquired if I was available to give a tribute. So I must begin by saying that I want to make a correction to the print, because we agree that eulogies have become too traditional. So a tribute in this case is more fitting, and I believe that when I start to give you facts and figures, then you'll understand why it is a tribute. I have made some notes for reference, but I am sure that during the course of the afternoon, my next few minutes, which obviously will be brief based on conditions, I'd be tempted to be impromptu, because I knew the man very well, and there are a lot of things that will probably come to mind as the evening proceeds. Andrew Augustus Clark, aka Andy or Hoggy, can be described as one, a renowned dancer, prominent bow legs and that flair. Two, an efficient waiter and bartender. Three, a motorcyclist who preferred the Vespa. Four, in question form, how can we forget his culinary skills, whether it be at home or at a function, or even socializing in our village? And five, he was a sweet talker. These were Felicia's words, because his sweet talk convinced her from the day that they met that she would be his wife and partner for the rest of their lives. No wonder he found it possible to contribute to the sugarcane harvest, because that too produced sweetness. He was a cane cutter for some time. There are other significant aspects of his sojourn on this earth which must be highlighted. A general commitment to family, and I'm tempted to say the village, even though in recent times we are all using improved vocabulary, so we talk about the community. A good example of commitment: when Jonathan was a primary school boy going to Ebenezer, that Vespa took him to school every morning. And I was reliably informed that Bonnellin was accompanied, or should I say, Bonnellin accompanied Jonathan even though she was not of school age. So she was a passenger. So could you imagine three persons on a Vespa? No wonder he chose the Vespa rather than the cycle, or the common Yamaha. On the other hand, though, Kathy, who lived in Sayers Court, benefited from his culinary skills. Every Sunday evening, he made sure that a special dish or bowl, a special container of food, was taken to Sayers Court for Kathy, which automatically had to be shared among many. I won't say how many. Obviously, the taste was natural and not artificial. Eventually, he bought a car because he complained of he was tearing it wet and stopping to have a shelter whenever the rain was falling. So this vehicle was really for family purposes and eventually taking his grandchildren to school. It must be noted that there were 7 grand boys, should I use that phrase, or 1 grand girl. And that grand girl worked him harder than the 7 boys because it was his responsibility to make sure that she did not go to sleep. But sorry, she did not want to go to sleep before her father came home. So her granddaddy was given the role to keep her awake. It is said that he relived his dancing days because he had to dance and play with her until Jonathan came home. Andy the employee, a waiter at the Silver Sands Hotel, Crane, Grand Barbados, Edgewater, becoming bar supervisor at the Rockley Resort, and this is where he provided transportation for me because I was without transportation and I used to go to Silver Hill to visit a friend. People are hear some exclamations. I better say a female, because if I say a friend in these days, people will wonder, was it male or female? However, it was a female friend and he knew that. And the agreement was to pick me up after work. So obviously it gave me enough time to spend with the female friend, because trying to go by a friend a Friday night, then to come back to the bus stand to get a midnight bus would obviously shorten my time with her. So here was Andy coming to the rescue, picking me up someplace at 3 o'clock in the morning. And poor me, on the back of the Vespa, outside real cold. And I got off live with it, because it was not a matter of saving bus fare, it was a matter of spending quality time with a partner. Extended hours, thanks to Andy. So after approximately 50 years, maybe more, in the hotel industry, he reached a stage where he decided to spend some time with his family. Well, not decided, he thought it best to spend more time and do more socially and in general in the Brayton village, because the Brayton cricket team, he was a number one supporter. There were other number ones, but he made sure that he was present whether they played at home or away. And with reference to support, he was a member and supporter of the Democratic Labour Party. And I believe that this originated because Warwick Franklin was born in Brayton, and because of Andy's village orientation and commitment to community, if I should use that word, a lot of us felt it necessary to support Warwick. And Andy was no less one of those key individuals who supported not only Warwick, but the DLP, and subsequently Dr. Estwick, who was also a product of the village. So then on evenings, he got caught up in a place we call the Senate, by the bus stop, where a lot of them met and had discussions. He would make his trek down to the bus stop every evening and made sure that by 6:45, he was heading home because he wanted to watch the 7 o'clock news. So at no time did Sunset find him, but 90% of the time, Sunset would have caught him between the step at his entrance and the 7 o'clock news. However, sickness curtailed his outdoor adventures. So at home, he extended his appreciation to his adopted son-in-law, who we call Ruru. And who eventually was of some assistance to Andy, and affectionately referred to him as Pops. That's right. Which obviously was a continual demonstration of the personality trait of commitment which Andy possessed as a daddy and as a friend. So at this stage, I would like to say a special or kind word of advice, or give a kind word of advice to Felicia and children Derek, Dave, Kathy Ann, Jonathan, Bonaline, and Rashida, and other relatives and friends. And my encouragement to you is to remain as a family. Give God thanks because He is our Creator. Let us make Him our guide. And I say us because I include myself and all those present. And as a conclusion, pray without ceasing. Amen. Thank you.
Scripture lesson, Psalm 46, our first reading, and you can remain seated for this one.
Good afternoon. Psalms 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore will not we fear, though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof, Selah. There is a river, the streams whereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right early. The heathen rage, the kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice, the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge, Selah. Come, behold the works of the Lord, what desolations he hath made in the earth. He maketh wars to cease unto the end of the earth. He breaketh the bow and cutteth the spear in sunder. He burneth the chariot in the fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge, Selah. Here ends this lesson.
Let's stand as we together sing, And Can It Be? And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's blood? Died He for me, who caused His pain, for me who Him to death pursued. Amazing love, how can it be that Thou, my God, Jesus died for me. Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, just died for me? He left his Father's throne above, so free, so infinite his grace. Emptied himself of all but love, and bled for Adam's fallen race. 'Tis mercy all immense and free, for oh my God, it found out me. 'Tis mercy all immense and free, for oh my God, it found out me. Long my imprisoned spirit lay, fast bound in sin and nature's night. Thine I diffuse a quickening ray, I woke the dungeon flame with light. My chains fell off, my heart was free, I rose, went forth and followed thee. My chains fell off, my heart was free, I rose, went forth and followed thee. No condemnation now I tread, Jesus and all in him is mine. Alive in him my living head, and clothed in righteousness divine. Bold I approach the eternal throne, and claim the crown to Christ my own. Bold I approach the eternal throne, and claim the crown through Christ my own. I'm going to ask that you remain standing as we have our second lesson, Revelation chapter 21, 1 through 7.
Second reading is taken from Revelation 21, verse 1 to 7. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. The first heaven and the first earth had disappeared, and there was no sea anymore. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God. It was prepared like a bride, dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, now God's presence is with people, and he will live with them, and they will be his people. God himself will be with them, and will be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death, sadness, crying, or pain, because all of the old ways are gone. The one who was sitting on the throne said, look, I am everything new. Then he said, write this, because these words are true
and can be trusted.
The one on the throne said to me, it is finished. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give free water from the spring of life
to anyone who is thirsty. Those who
win the victory will receive this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children. Here ends the reading.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. You may sit, please. The Gospel according to St. John, the 14th chapter, and the first four verses from the New Living Translation says to us, "Don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. There's more than enough room in my Father's home. If this were not so, would I have told you I'm going to prepare a place for you? When everything is ready, I will come and get you, so that you will always be with me where I am." And verse 4 says, "And you know the way to where I am going." For us to really capture what would have given rise to these words spoken by Jesus Christ to his disciples, we would have to pick it up in chapter 13. Chapter 13 of St. John's Gospel speaks to a number of things which seemingly could cause one to be uneasy. So when you look at chapter 13, it speaks about Jesus' betrayal, and we know that, and Judas and so on. It speaks about Peter's denial, because Peter was saying, you know, I'm going to go with you all the way. And Jesus Christ would have reminded him, you're going to deny me. But nestled in all of that, Jesus was also said to them, "A new commandment that I am giving you, that you love one another." So in the midst of what seemingly is chaos and confusion, challenging words, Jesus said to them, "A new commandment I am giving to you, that you love one another." And then in chapter 14, it opens by saying, "Don't let your hearts be troubled." Jesus Christ was readying his disciples for his departure. And even though he was readying them for his departure, when it came, they were still challenged. Their world was rocked. And when I thought about that, I thought about death. Nothing can really ready us for death. We know that one might be sick, one might be suffering, one might be in pain. We know that doctors might say they just have a few more weeks, a few more months. And even though we are mentally preparing ourselves for that time, when it comes, it still knocks us for six. And Jesus said to his disciples, "Don't let your hearts be troubled." I want to suggest to us this afternoon that Jesus Christ has a way of calming our fears. If I had to ask every person present this afternoon, "You want to die?" And I'm sure that the answer that is going to come back to me is no. But Jesus was able to calm the disciples' fears. He said to them, "Don't let your heart be troubled." Again, I think of all that is happening around us. And I'm sure that most of us would agree, sometimes we are gripped by fear. But the words of Jesus Christ to us this evening is, "Do not let your heart be troubled." So he caused them, or he helped them, to calm their fears. Because yes, he knew that he was going to leave them. Yes, he knew that he was going to die. Yes, he knew he was going to suffer, etc. But he's saying, "Don't let your hearts be troubled." He calmed their fears. The second thing I want to suggest to us this afternoon is that not only did Jesus Christ calm their fears, but he helped them to cement their faith. He said to them, believe in God, believe also in me. When difficult times come, and trust me, difficult times will come. And they come in different forms, but difficult times come. When difficult times come, that is the time that we have to know the God that we serve. It is all right when things are going smoothly, but when we hit a rough spot, that is when our faith is tested. That is when our faith is tried. So Jesus Christ was able to help his disciples to cement their faith. Believe in God, believe also in me. The question is, when we are faced with the challenges of life, how do we respond? As Mr. Sargent, we would affectionately call him Sarge, read his tribute, my mind went back to Anderson. And I pictured him with the green Vespa. And if you really had an idea as to how the men would ride Vespas back in the day, they were not like the youngsters today who would pull wheels, but they had a way of moving off. Their foot wasn't touching the ground, but it was just off the ground, and they move off really fast. I think Anderson would have mastered that. And then I again, as the tribute was being read, my mind went back to him being a dancer. Again, if you knew him well, you would have known that he's not a very tall man, but he was able to dance and command any stage. The part that I would have to have some conversation is about the sweet talker. So I would have to have some conversation to be able to get a hang of what the hook line was somewhat, maybe 29, 30 years ago. What was that hook line that would have swept this beautiful lady off her feet to become his wife and his wife for a long time? Maybe we'll have a conversation a little later to hear those words. I'm sure it was not words like, I would give you my heart and work off of batteries. I'm sure it was not those kind of words, but I believe it probably was something like, from the moment that I would have set my eyes on you, I knew in no uncertain terms that you were the one for me. You are the love of my life, and I would do anything to claim you as my own. Sounds like something you would have said. I'm not sure, but yes. But I want to say to us that in spite or despite how a sweet talker he was, Jesus Christ was able to give us some instructions that would have helped us and is helping us to be able to cement our faith. And there are a number of questions that we would sometimes ask ourselves. And I'm not sure about you, but certainly sometimes I have to ask myself, this thing called death, I really can't understand it. Matter of fact, the Apostle Paul would have said that the last enemy to be destroyed is death. I really cannot grasp. Because sometimes you want to have the loved one there with you, and you're looking forward to times together, and then they're just snatched. Simply says, believe in God, believe also in me. And I'm saying that for his disciples, their world was rocked when he left them. Their world was rocked. The one who was with them for all those years, the one who would have taught them, the one who would have sat at meals with them, the one who would have encouraged them, he was no leaving them, but he helped them to cement their faith. And I want to say to you this afternoon, family and friends, that you have to cement your faith. And your faith in God, because then, as a song says, on Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. I want to submit to us this afternoon that our faith in God, our faith in Christ, enables us to weather the storms of life. So Jesus Christ did not only calm their fears. You know, when children enter primary school, sometimes they start to cry. And then they would want to run behind the parents and so on, because it's a new environment. And the parents would try to calm them. Jesus Christ calms our fears. Then when everything gives way around us, Jesus Christ is encouraging us to cement our faith. And then Jesus Christ says something to us. He speaks not only about his going, I'm going away, but he also says that he is coming again. So hear what Jesus says to us. I am going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself. The King James says that where I am, there ye may be also. I want to say to us that those are comforting words. So Jesus Christ assured his disciples, I am a place for you. Matter of fact, he says, in my Father's house are many mansions, are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? No. I know that there is much debate, and I really am not about to debate all the little things in relation to that. But what I would say to us, if Jesus Christ has promised us that he's going to prepare a place for us, if he has promised us that he is going to come again and receive him and receive us unto himself, that where he is, there we might be also. Well, I'm not too concerned where he is. I'm not concerned about the size of the room. I'm not concerned about the look of the room. Nothing of the sort. I simply want to be with Jesus Christ. And I think the plus to that is what the writer in Revelation would have said. There will be no more death. And I just anticipate that day when there will be no more death. He also speaks there will be no more sickness. Could you imagine? You have diabetes, you have hypertension, you have a whole set of non-communicable diseases and so on. And now we are still battling the coronavirus and so on. But the writer to Revelation, in the book of Revelation says to us, there will be no more death. There will be no more sickness. There will be no more crying, no more tears. And I want to suggest to us that I look forward to that day. The reality is, as we continue on this journey called life, there's sickness, there's pain, there's suffering. But one day, that is going to change. One day, all of that is going to change. To the family, I would not stand here and say to you, don't grieve. I am not going to mislead you I know persons would say, oh, you have to be strong and you have to do this and you have to do that. I want to say to you, grief, it is part of the process. But I also want to say to you that as you go through this time, recognize that you're not alone because Jesus Christ is with you, and recognize that you have the family support which is necessary to help you to get over this. So you need that family support, and the joy of the family support is that sometimes you might not be on top of the mountain, but another family member is there to help you. So I want to suggest to you that as you weather this storm, as you come to grips with a place, a seat at the table now vacant, a voice that you are accustomed hearing, you're no longer hearing, I want to say to you, you're going to get through this together as family. To the friends, well-wishers, I want to suggest to you that don't just call tomorrow and then that's it. But periodically, check in. How are you doing? How are you managing? It is not a case of you want to hug the shore, as they would say, you're talking. No. You are just allowing them to know that you are present just in case. So you do your check-in. And remember, Jesus Christ simply said, coming on the heels of his discourse with his disciples, betrayal, denial, he says, I'm giving you a new commandment. Love one another as I have loved you. And we know the extent of Christ's love for us. As you go through this, again, be reminded that Jesus Christ, he calms our fears. He calms our fears. Be reminded that Jesus Christ is pushing us and encouraging us to cement our faith. It is not the kind of faith that would give up when trials and testings come, but it is the kind of faith and confidence and belief in this one who is able to speak to storms, this one who is able to calm storms, Jesus Christ himself. And be reminded of the promise that he has made to us. I'm going to prepare a place for you. So in conclusion, one of the lessons that was read, Psalm 46, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in time of trouble. And it goes on to say, the Lord of hosts is with us. The Lord of heaven's armies is with us. And the God of Jacob is with us. Our refuge. My friends, I want to say to us, as we continue on this journey called life, simply trust God. He is the only person, whether we want to accept it or not, that has never failed. I want to take this opportunity to extend sincere condolences to his wife, children, grands, other relatives and friends. And I want you to know that we are here for you. When I say that, I mean that. We are here for you. Because the reality is, we don't know when we'll be faced with a similar situation and we'll need a shoulder to lean on. So let's stand together as we would ask God's blessing on the family at this time, as we stand. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful to you this afternoon because your ears are always open to our cries. We can come to you when we are weary, when we are heavy laden. We can come to you because you have instructed us that we can cast our cares on you because you care for us. And so, Lord God, at this time we pray in a very special way for the family of the late Andrew. We are asking, Lord God, that you would undergird them with your strength as they would face the days, the weeks, the months, the years ahead. We pray, Lord God, that they would be conscious of your nearness. We pray, Lord God, that your comfort would be theirs. We pray that through this experience, they would be able to comfort others who might be going through or who will go through a similar experience. And so, Lord God, we commend them to you at this time. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. Our final hymn before we do the interment. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. Oh, when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. While we walk the pilgrim's pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sun. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we will sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we will sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize be. Man born of a woman has but a short time to live. Like a flower, he blossoms and then withers. Like a shadow, he flees and never stays. In the midst of life, we are in death. To whom can we turn to for help but to you, O Lord, who are justly angered by our sins? Lord God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, holy and most merciful Savior, deliver us from the bitter pains of eternal death. You know the secrets of our hearts. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive us our sins, and at our last hour, let us not fall away from you. Ensuring certain hope of resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to Almighty God our brother Andrew Augustus. We commit his body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. And we beseech you in your infinite goodness to give us grace to live in your dear love and to die in your favor, that when your beloved Son shall come again in judgment, both this our brother and we ourselves may be found acceptable in your sight. Grant this for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, with whom still live the spirits of those who die in the Lord, and with whom the souls of the faithful are in joy and felicity, We give you heartfelt thanks for the good examples of all your servants who, having finished their course in faith, now find rest and refreshment. Amen.
Your grace is sufficient to keep us, for your strength is made perfect when we're weak. When the road is long and heavy, when it's dark and darkened, see clearly. I will lift my eyes to thy ears from whence my help cometh. My help comes from you. Lead me, oh, lead me, oh, lead me to where I've never been before, a place I've never seen. When I come to the end of myself, Father, carry me. Father, carry me. When I come to the end of myself, Father, carry me. When I come to the end of myself, Father, carry me. Father, carry me. Yeah. When I come to the end of myself, Father, carry me.
one thing that I to him he will give me light. Satan says, may vex the soul, turn my thoughts aside. But my Lord goes ahead, leaves whatever betide. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, there to sing forever of a saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. Oh, sister, when in valleys low I look toward the mountain height, and behold my Savior there leading in the fight, with a tender hand upstretched towards the valley low, guiding me I can see as I onward go. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. When before me billows rise from the mighty deep, then my Lord directs my path, he doth safely keep. And he leads me gently on through this world below. He's a real friend to me, oh, I love him so. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice.
There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar. For the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there, in the sweet by and by.
There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar. For the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there, in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore, in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. We shall sing on that beautiful shore the melodious songs of the blessed, and our spirits shall sorrow no more, not a sigh for the blessing of rest. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore, in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. To our bountiful Father above, we will offer the tribute of praise for the glorious gift of his love and the blessings that hallow our days. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone, because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. Because he lives. The day thou givest, Lord, is ended.
Thank you. You're all alone, alone. Tell me, what do you give when you're giving your all? And seems like you can't make it through. Well, you just stand when there's nothing left to do.
Let me take this opportunity. Immediate and extended to say thank you for coming to share with them in their time of loss. May God continue to bless you, travel safely, and stay safe. God bless.
Tell me, how do you handle the guilt of your past? Tell me, how do you deal with the shame? Smile while your heart has been broken and filled with pain, tell me, what do you give when you've given your all? Yeah. Seems like you can't make it through. Child, you just stand when there's nothing left to do. You just stand, watch the Lord see you through. Yes, after you've done all you can, you just stand and be sure you're not entangled in that bondage of.
After you've gone through